There's an old saying about theory and practice. In theory, everything should work perfectly. In practice, nothing works perfectly and nobody knows why. And it's kind of true here as well, that RNA sequencing theory is that you need to have statistical significance. Anybody actually know what that means for RNA-seq? Has anybody sat down and tried to do a power analysis? Anyone? Bueller? No. So somebody did. Somebody wrote a really good paper. Actually, there's a couple of them, but this is a table that, an Excel spreadsheet calculator that they built for this, talking about what kind of sample you have and how much power you need to actually be able to do it. You can download this yourself and open it. The point here being that if you are trying to do your analysis and have what statisticians would refer to as actual statistical power, what you're trying to do is perform this experiment and never have to do anything afterwards. That the experiment itself is sufficient to draw conclusions from. To do that, you need to have a high-quality reference, you need to have a lot of samples, and you need to be able to be certain that everything else is right. If you want to do that, and we can play with this later if you guys are interested, I'm going to skip it as much as I can because we have to be out of the room by 3:30 today, but we can talk about it either during lunch or tomorrow if you guys have real questions. Generally, if you want to use an effect size of 2 and have, say, even a p-value of 0.1, you're going to need a certain number of samples. I'm going to download this into Excel so that we can look at it a little bit better. So at the very top of the page, you can grab, attachments. One of them is powercalculator.xls, and you're welcome to use it at any point, but I'm going to put it up here to prove the point. So, if you assume that there is alpha and beta variation at what I think would be considered somewhat normal levels, and you want to be able to differentiate statistically between your two conditions at a two-fold variation fold change, you need 99 samples per condition. Easy. No problem. Everybody can do that, right? We all have infinite money and don't have any kind of problem. By the same virtue, if you go down and you want to flip it the other way, what can I actually statistically validate based on what I've done? If I assume that all of these other numbers are okay, and I just want to say how many samples I have, this is assuming that I have 50 samples. So if I want to say that I have a much more normal and expected 5 samples,
the minimum amount of fold change I have to see to be able to statistically declare that I believe that this gene is differentially expressed is 22-fold.
What does that mean for everybody in this room? What it means, at least to me, is that you can do all the statistics in the world and enjoy it and
spend all of your time working on the statistics, but there's almost no condition that I expect that you're going to be able to perform an RNA-seq experiment and walk away. You're going to have to do something afterwards, right? Part of what your goal in RNA-seq analysis, the same as it was with microarrays, is to find as few genes as possible that might be interesting to validate. Not to give yourself as much power as possible, not to do anything else. Just make sure that you get the best set of answers you can so that when you go back down the road to actually analyze these, you don't end up with 300 genes that you have to individually knock out and validate that you have a change in behavior in. most importantly in that is the zero question. There's a bunch of things that you want to think about when you talk about how much sequencing to do. The zero question for me is, what are you trying to find? If you're trying to find differentially expressed genes, that is a different question than if you are trying to find differential splice variants. And if you're trying to do both with the same experiment, it's very easy to get in the weeds. So be careful and make sure before you do sequencing, if possible, that you know what you're getting into. So, the next statement, I talk about model and semi-model organisms. The list right now, at least in my opinion, is that human, mouse, rat, Arabidopsis, C. elegans, Drosophila, and most bacterial species count as model organisms. The genome is well described, the gene models are well described, it's relatively straightforward to do an RNA sequencing analysis. When you get into semi-model organisms, it gets a little bit more confusing. There's a longer list of those because those are what the majority of plants, animals, fungi all fall into. Algal species are almost all somewhere in the semi-model genome set. They have a mostly complete genome reference, but the gene model is usually terrible, and that's the problem. With a bacteria, once you have a complete genome, the gene model is easy because there are no introns and exons. With eukaryotes, once you get to a finished genome, or even a semi-finished genome, now you have to be able to actually predict what genes are there, what actual introns and exons exist, and none of that is easy without experimental data. So without a lot of experimental data, which you happen to get from model organisms, the gene models are terrible. And that means that your ability to predict what genes are going to be up and down regulated or even expressed at all is going to be predicated on assumptions that you may not believe. So things get more difficult when you get to semi-model organisms. If you don't have a finished genome, good luck. I'm sorry. You're doing RNA-seq on an organism without a reference genome, and there are a couple of tools to do de novo genome assembly. I wish you the best of luck. I think that perhaps the money might have been better spent to finish the genome than to do an RNA-seq. Again, personal opinion, you're welcome to try. I just am afraid that you're not going to get as much out of it as you would hope. There's a time-benefit ratio problem there. Okay, so I have said a lot of things. There are two links at the bottom of that in terms of what Titus thinks is good advice, and then links to some papers on RNA-seq analysis if you want to read them.